This is the Lisa Wesson Show, where we look at transformation in all its forms through mindfulness, creativity, holistic health and healing, all kinds of events in personal consciousness, and of course, how can we be more useful and peaceful in the world. And I'm Lisa Wesson, your host. Today, I'm very pleased to have with us Elise Brouillette, who is sort of a neighbor from Chelmsford, Massachusetts, and I became aware of Lisa's work recently, and it's a pleasure to share this with the community, locally and on YouTube as well. So, Elise, thank you for joining us today.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Yes, it's been a pleasure. So tell us, how did you start this quilting? When did you start quilting?
I think I started about 16 years ago, and for me it was a perfect blend of my background in textiles and interior design. Gave me a chance to play with fabrics, pattern, color, all my favorite things, scale. And I've just really enjoyed the journey.
Yes, and there's such an array of styles of Elise's work, which I have to say, from wall hangings to quilts to ottomans, and we have some slides to show on some of this work, but let's start with the ones that are in the studio. So let's take a look at this quilt from, tell us about this quilt behind us from St. Jude's.
It's a donation for St. Jude's. It's a pattern I came across this year, and I just felt it was really powerful, and I thought it would be great for a kid's room, for a kid's donation, to play with the superpower cartoons and the stars, and just really upbeat and cheery. So every year I do a lot of charity quilts for different causes. Lowell Wish I've done a lot for.
Are they lucky? And they get these quilts. And
yeah, a lot of baby quilts, a lot of children's quilts and pillowcases. But this, I just,
it
said something to me.
And we have actually a picture of Elise in her studio. Pete, could we see slide number 10? Elise creating, this is the picture of Elise, her studio where she was making this quilt. There she is. So that was the quilt on the table and in process.
Yes, just finishing the top.
Just beautiful. So I've heard it said by one of your peers, Bonnie Hunter. Can we see slide number 2? That quilting is not a hobby. It's an occupation, an obsession, a fascination, an addiction, self-expression, and a way of life.
It is.
And Bonnie calls herself a hopeless scrapaholic on her website. So would you agree with that?
All of that is true, and more.
And
because
more.
We use a lot of recycling of clothing and people's garments and, you know, it's we're magpies.
I love the recycling part of it. You know that, as it happens, in 2009, I was the recycling champion of Chelmsford.
Really?
There was a picture of me in the news. I can send you the picture of me by my composter. I'm a big recycler, and Bonnie Rankin, who's a local librarian, is aware of how much recycling I do in my house, and I have composting going on and whatever. And I love the recycling aspect of the quilts. And speaking of that, I love the picture of your mother. Can we see slide number 7 of your mother's golf skirts? Tell us about the golf skirts.
Well, occasionally, when someone passes, I'll offer to take a portion of their garments and clothing and reassemble them. So these were all golf skirts of my mother's.
Isn't
They're all
something?
Lily Pulitzers from the 70s. And, you know,
a
better
love it.
Preppy thing than whales. So I just upcycled them into a quilt, which I've done maybe half a dozen with t-shirts. I've done them with men's shirts for... I've done them with ties.
I love the idea. Yeah. That could be quite a cottage industry. It's like taking people's clothes.
It is.
And making, repurposing them.
Yeah.
We also have one that you did for your brother, your mother, your wife, the mother-in-law. Can we see slide number 9, the recycled ties made into ottomans? Pete, number 9, that's it. That blew my mind.
Yeah, that
so
was really fun.
So these are, tell us about this.
They're my father-in-law's ties, and my mother, he wore a tie every day, and my mother-in-law gave me all of them after his passing, and it took me a while, it takes a while to gel with the right use.
Mm-hmm.
And then all of a sudden I was taking a Tuffet class, and I made the one in the background, and I thought, oh my gosh.
I just love it.
You use long, skinny pieces of fabrics. Ties are perfect.
And also it's exquisite. It's actually a beautiful piece of furniture.
It's
very Louis XIV. I mean, the whole look is very sumptuous and gorgeous.
Yeah. She loves it.
It's a great use of recycling. So tell us some. Now let's see. Let's look at some of her other work. We have in the, so in the studio we have this beautiful turquoise masterpiece of, is it waves? It looks like waves or something here.
Yep.
So this is waves.
Beautiful batiks.
Beautiful
batiks.
It's called
Snail Trail, actually. And it does look like waves and kind of.
It's one of my favorites. Thank you for bringing that in today. And now, Pete, let's do a walk through her quilts. We have from the slides starting with number 3. Let's look at some of the slides. That's the pineapple quilt.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to tell us about that?
Those are a challenge. There are thousands of pieces of fabric.
It's more complicated. Pineapple is very difficult, labor-intensive.
Very, but it's actually a really traditional pattern, and it's fun to bring modern colors and have a new uptake on an old traditional piece.
It's beautiful. Yeah. And let's look at the next, the close-up of the pineapple. Okay, we have a close-up. We can move quicker. The red, white, and blue stars, very patriotic.
Yep. And I thought those were great for St. Jude's kids as well.
St. Jude's kids.
Very cheery, uplifting, cozy.
Yes. Yeah, they're so lucky. And the tiger face is fantastic. Now, this is a wall hanging?
That's a wall hanging. I'm hoping to make a much bigger. It's a double wedding ring, which, again, is a really traditional pattern.
Mm-hmm.
But doing it with a little uptick of some tigers, batiks.
Yes, it's beautiful. And let's look at the, there's then your mother's skirt. We had covered that one. And the blue stars, there's a big blue star one coming up. Okay.
Yeah.
That one is also beautiful. Is that an extra large one?
No, it's a little wall hanging.
Oh,
it's actually like a baby quilt size.
Oh, it's hard to tell from the slide.
It's hanging in a therapist's office.
Oh,
yeah.
I can see that.
Yeah.
All right, great. So we've been able to go through those slides, and there's more. Elise has hundreds and hundreds of these quilts.
It's surprising. On Instagram, when I reviewed to go back to look at slides for tonight, I was exhausted looking at them all.
There's so much work involved. Now tell us about the community. What really fascinates me is you're in these quilting communities where you get together and with women regularly, like the way people do knitting groups. She does. So tell us about your quilting groups.
I have two groups I sew with that I've sewn with for probably 10 years. And we meet, some of us every Tuesday and some of us every Wednesday. And it's really like the old-fashioned quilting bee. We know each other really well. And it's just a community, and we can really bounce ideas off each other and talk about the process and talk about where we're at. And certain people have different styles, so it's really fun to be in the mix.
Right. And that's really the healing power. When I use the word healing with quilting, what I'm talking about is you de-stress by being with these lovely friends, and you're one-mindedly, you're mindfully doing one thing at a time as you focus on the fabrics and the, whatever, the beads, whatever you get to. And you're not doing digital. It's completely real-time, real stuff. And it soothes the brain. I mean, the brain loves doing one thing at a time. So it's very
repetitive.
Doing one thing at a time repetitively, whether it's knitting or needlework or quilting, it's very good for relaxation. Obviously, there's a lot of knitting groups, too, you know. But what you do is so social. And you travel. I mean,
I know you travel
for quilting.
I go to California. There's an incredible
quilting
place
conferences.
Out in Asilomar, where I'll go for a week and study with one teacher. So I'll be with her for 5 full days, all day, every day, and really get the breadth of their knowledge and really be able to take it in and really spend a lot of time producing something over the course of the week.
That must be a wonderful experience.
It's the best.
Yes.
But there's a lot of quilt guilds in New England, and they are wonderfully social, and they have shows, and they have show and tell every month. So there's a lot of...
Oh, yeah, we're in the heart. I mean, New England is one of the heartlands for quilting, I think. Although they're becoming so popular. Weren't you telling me that after September 11th, crafting went, what'd you say, it went way up?
People really needed to draw back and focus in and create. Mm-hmm. And I think knitting really had an uptick, quilting as well. I think, you know, people needed to kind of dial it back a little. And
yeah. It's the focusing and the being able to do something together quietly, repetitively. It's very soothing. And that contributes to healing insofar as it's not going to cure you if you have cancer or Lou Gehrig's disease. It's not going to cure. But healing involves feeling better. When I use the word healing, I use it very broadly. It makes you feel better, more peaceful, more relaxed.
Well, I think it's
that's
like
the healing effect.
It's like gardening.
Yes,
you know, if you look at the big picture, it's overwhelming.
Right.
But if you say, I'm going to cut fabric today, I'm going to start blocks tomorrow, and then in a month I'll have a quilt.
Exactly, exactly. I know, and I do gardening and I grow orchids, and there's definitely a point where I realize, you know, they have to be repotted at least every 2 years. And repotting is, do you repot plants? You know how nasty it is?
Oh,
it's
I'm
a dirty.
Not a good indoor
I need
plant.
Mike Rowe. It's a dirty job. It's like, I do it. I mean, my husband laughs. He goes, why do you do this? Because but it has to be one pot. I do three at a time or four at a time. Like, I used to have 50. Now I'm down to like 30 orchids, but it must get done. But it actually, once I get into it, it's a rhythm and it's slow.
It's a bonsai.
I don't use bonsai, no. But I just like to have to, you know, cutting the roots, whatever. I don't get it. It's a hassle and it's very dirty. The stuff gets all over the house. Let's move on. So Elise's quilts are available. If you want to visit her on Elise's quilt at Instagram at Elise's quilts. Pete has that on the subtitle of your
trailer.
It's showing along. So Elise's quilts, and tell us your phone number again. If anybody wants to call Elise, don't be shy. She makes quilts on demand, on request. If you want that, it's possible. Even though she's very busy with her other things.
I'm not high tech. I don't have a website. Right. I've kind of made peace with that. If people want to call me, 978-807-2001. Mm-hmm. I'll direct them, help them.
Do you teach classes? Do you need teaching?
I teach friends occasionally, but not really. Mm-hmm. I'm not an exacting person. I know you look at these and it looks like I might be, but I am not a perfectionist.
There's a lot going on. Well, thank you for bringing these in today. So now we're going to switch gears and we're going to talk about Elise's beading work. So let's just discuss the beading work. Now, are we going to take a pause
and play a video?
Yes. So let's look at that. Let's look at that video of the effect of malas. How to work with a mala string. Thank you, Pete.
A mala is a counting device. It's used to count the number of mantra repetitions completed during a period of meditation. One repetition per bead. A mala also serves as a physical cue for reciting a mantra. As fingers slide from bead to bead, the mala helps to sustain the mantra even when other thoughts pass through the mind. Most malas have 108 beads. In addition, there's one extra bead, the tasseled miru bead, it's called. This additional bead marks the beginning and the end of each cycle. Even though there's 108 beads per mala, only 100 beads are credited for the trip around. This makes counting a little bit easier. So when you do 7 malas, that indicates that you've completed 700 repetitions. It also accounts for the fact that sometimes the mind wanders a bit during meditation. To use a mala, begin by holding the mala suspended from the ring finger. As you repeat the mantra, draw the mala one bead at a time towards you with your thumb. By convention, after completing a circuit around the entire mala, you do not cross the miru bead. Instead, reposition the mala and return in the other direction. It can be a bit of a trick to negotiate this change. To accomplish this, hold the last bead with your thumb and third finger, slide the ring finger out, and reverse the direction of the mala. The last bead now becomes the first, and japa begins again. Malas can be made of many different materials. Some are made of crystal and gems, or sandalwood, red and white. But the most widely used and versatile malas are made from rudraksha seeds. Rudraksha means tears of Shiva and symbolizes limitless compassion. Good malas have knots between each bead. This prevents the beads from sliding into one another, abrading the string, and separating as the string stretches with wear. It's important to remember that the material and construction of the mala is not as important as the sincerity with which you bring the mantra to mind. The point is to enlist the mala in the service of your practice. Using a mala enables you to track your progress, and it also helps you to keep focused on your mantra during meditation. When the mind wanders, your mala will be there, gently guiding your attention back to the sound of the mantra.
So I love how he demonstrates the proper way to use the mala. Now, something what somebody once told me, as with meditation, the only way to do it wrong is to not do it at all. If you get a mala, or you get it, beads or rosary, whatever you're using, don't fear that you're not doing it right. But there is, what this guy showed us in the video, is that there's a way to do this where, whether you're doing repetitive prayer or chants or just, this too shall pass, this too shall pass. When I use beads, I have some beads at home that I use. I also don't say the same thing over and over, like, you know, all is well. In this moment, all is well, all is well. And that makes me feel better. I mean, frankly, it doesn't have to be a big prayer, you know, cavalcade, you know. So tell us about your beading and how did you start beading? When did it become a part of your life?
Very young. Mm-hmm. I was into love beads, and then I quickly progressed into African trading beads and really loved those. I grew up outside of Manhattan, and my brother would bring me home some trading beads every now and then after work.
Oh, and nice.
The advent of malas, I don't know, for me, I think I became aware of them maybe 3 or 4 years ago and started the knotting of the beads. Mm-hmm. And that's a really lovely process to just sit and knot. Takes a little hang, you know, it takes a little bit to figure out how to do it, but once you get the hang of it, you know, you're buying beads and you're making necklaces. I think I quickly stepped away from 108 for practical reasons. Shorter people, they're too long.
Right. And is that one 108?
I don't know.
So let's can we see slide number 11 about malas, please? Let's take a look at that. Thank you, Pete. So basically, the malas are an Eastern rosary, and they're used for keeping count while reciting, chanting, or mentally repeating a prayer or intention, or the name of a deity or an angel. I mean, I know people who use beads, and they go like, thank you God, thank you Jesus, thank you Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, thank you Michael, Gabriel, Raphael, Metatron, like the list from their tradition, you know, and they use them that way. Is that part of your tradition? Did you use the beads in any kind of meditative way?
No, I just love the vibration of them.
The vibration of them,
and
the crystals.
I love the feel of them. A lot of times I'm using semi-precious stones and the colors. Once people start wearing them, they love it.
They
it
do
quickly
feel good.
Becomes like every day I'm not dressed unless I have a few malas on.
I know, you always have an array of them on. They're beautiful. There's like a navy assortment here.
Yeah.
They're terrific. And I've seen Elise wearing turquoise and purple ones and all different colors. So let's see some of the slides from the Elise's beads. Can we see slides 12 through 13, Pete? Slides 12 through 13, there. There's a close-up of the guru bead with the endings, which are lovely. And then we have your assortment of colors and textures and things at the bottom are beautiful. And let's look at the rosary, too. Slide number 14 is fun. So the rosary is from the Latin rosarium, which means the crown of roses or garland of roses. And I love that this is something that comes from both traditions. In the Eastern tradition and the Western tradition, we have the beads. And if you go on Google and you look for rosary beads, you'll see hundreds of pictures of, you know, and there's turquoise ones and like this. I mean, similar to all shapes and sizes. So tell me, when you do your beading, do you do that in groups also? Is that part of your community?
I do, actually. It's a little more free form. I'll have friends over in the evening and we'll sit around and bead, drink cocktail hour, and it's really contagious. Once you start doing it, everybody loves it. And
do you have beading trays? Do you have a beading tray? How do you work?
I have them. I tend to just have like a little pin box that I'll put a whole two strands of beads loose in there with my thread and a needle and tweezers. So I have this little, I can travel if I'm on a bus and just sit there and knot and bead, and I'm off and going. But it's something I do during the summer.
So you
can kind of switch mediums.
You cannot beads on a bus. It doesn't get
too. I can do it anywhere.
I imagine it's very relaxing. It's
again
that
very
rhythmic,
relaxing.
Repetitive activity without digital, without screening.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It sounds probably to some people that it would be tedious, but it's not. It's very relaxing.
It's soothing. And how long does it take you approximately to make one of these things once you've picked out your stones?
Probably an hour, and then maybe another half an hour playing with a tassel. Sometimes I'm putting in shells.
Let's see a tassel, yeah.
Sometimes I have shells in the tassels. Sometimes I'm cutting up silk, I'm using ribbon.
Oh, this is beautiful, yes. Oh, you do the cutting. Mm-hmm.
So it depends, but you know, within 2 hours I can finish a piece.
Just lovely.
And I sell those as well during the summer. They're really popular, kind of summer jewelry, travel jewelry.
You have a show coming up, don't you, coming up?
Yes.
Tell us about that.
In June, I'm having a booth at a craft show in West Hampton Beach in Long Island, and I'll have all my quilts
what
and my wares. It's June 3rd, 4th, Saturday, Sunday,
okay.
All day. I'll be there.
You've got to send me those cards to tell my friends. I've got to send my friends in the Hamptons to come see your quilts.
Yes,
see
I need
there.
People to come in and talk to me because it'll be a very nerve-wracking experience of 2 full days of talking about myself.
2 full days of at the table. Quilts and beads going to be
yes.
there?
Yes.
Is that indoors or outdoors?
It's outdoors. It's kind of a street fair.
In a tent?
In a tent. And it's
very
mostly
exciting.
Fine art, but they're mm-hmm. squeezing me in this year.
Excellent. Congratulations.
Thank you. It's a big step.
It is a big step. And again, you can find Elise's work at Elise's Quilts at Instagram. And you can call her if you want her to make a mala for you or whatever. Rosaries, too, I guess you can make.
A lot of people, they're healing mm-hmm. as well. People will say, I would like rose quartz. I have this going on in my life, and this is the gem I need. Or
certain stones.
Labradorite has a different vibration. And people will come to me and say, I need, you know, X. Mm-hmm.
I once went to a therapist who told me that I should wear, when I first got married, I should wear a lapis lazuli around my neck because it helps open up the communication chakra for better communication.
Interesting. I can't so imagine you having that issue.
I know. You'd be surprised. Not to too much disclosure here, but like my first thought, when she said that, my first thought was, you know, I'm a skeptical New Yorker. I'm open-minded and I'm skeptical. So I said, I'm paying her this money to hear the prayer lapis on my neck. You know, but then actually I went shopping and I actually have a lapis necklace that I wear. And in the first 2 years of my marriage, I was wearing it a lot, you know, to help me improve my communication skills. Anyway, and you know, and there's something to it, and I do love wearing lapis. It feels good on my body. Turquoise, too, feels very good. I have a turquoise ring that I wear that I just feel good in it. I don't know what it does, but, you know.
It's good stuff.
When people have something like a serious illness, like cancer or Parkinson's, is there a certain stone you recommend?
I think research it, because I think for individuals, we all have different vibrations, and mm-hmm. our illnesses are in different parts of our bodies, so mm-hmm. you have to really go online. There's a lot of choices.
Right. I was once told, too, there's a great store in Andover. A friend of mine has them. It's called Circles of Wisdom. Have mm-hmm. you ever heard of it? It's on 90 Main Street. I love Kathy Levinson. She runs it. And she once said that she knows a lot about gems. She said that when you go into a store that has a lot of gemstones, see what you're drawn to. If something calls to you, forget what the books all say. Like, you know, if you feel hematite is calling you, or lapis, or jade.
I totally agree.
That's the one for you. And, and you hold it in your hand, and you put it on your body, and see how it feels. And there's some truth to that, I think.
There is, absolutely.
And I know turquoise. I just really feel good in turquoise. And do you find that people will shift, like after a while of wearing amethyst, they just come back. They want a different gemstone. Things change. They want a different stone. Does that ever happen?
I think people do change. Some people are comfortable with bigger pieces of jewelry. Other people like tiny, more. Mm-hmm. Subtle pieces, but mm-hmm. I do think they change, mm-hmm. especially when they see all my new work.
You have a lot going on.
Yeah.
I know. Elise cranks out these quilts. Like every week a quilt is coming out of that.
Well, that's because I'm doing the show. I am in
hyper mode. You're in hyper mode, yeah. So, again, I want to thank you for joining us today.
It's been
a pleasure having you here. St. Jude's is so blessed to have this quilt coming. And I don't know how they're going to choose which kid. Is it going to go in one of their rooms in the hospital? Or is they going to give it to somebody?
I don't know. Paul thinks I should go down
and
actually present them because I have a whole pile to go.
I agree. I think it's a huge effort. And also, it's a lovely gesture. They're so lucky to be getting that from you. It's amazing.
Well, they're lucky they get them from all over the country.
People donate to St.
That's
Jude's.
That's a big part of quilting is donating.
Oh, how nice.
Quilters are very generous.
I love that energy. And also, it really makes a room just come alive. It just comes alive when there's a quilt in the room. And when I graduated from high school, my mother had a quilt made for me in Vermont, one of those Texas stars. And the colors, those colors at the time were mauve, turquoise, teal. And to this day, I mean, I have it, hangs in my living room. I love this quilt. And so we're wrapping up. This has been the Lisa Wesson Show, and it's been a pleasure to have Elise Brouillette from Chelmsford. She's at Instagram at Elise's Quilts, and you can reach her at 978-807-2001. Right, and you can contact me for my contact information on this last slide. Pete, thanks for putting up the contact.